So growing up, I would take long walks through the streets of Bangalore with my mother. And that's the city that she grew up in. And as we'd walk, she'd point out how the city had changed from when she was a kid, where in front of us stood well-lit streets, was once forest land that turned pitch black once the sun set. And where we saw apartment blocks and shopping centers was once just space in between buildings. She'd also point out how some buildings didn't change one bit. And I would listen in amazement because I get to see the city for what it once was. And I'd also get this time lapse of a cityscape popping up in front of me, buildings, roads being paved, people flooding in, and slowly forming into the city that I was in. But this isn't the story of just Bangalore. It's the story of every city. This is Shanghai in 2020. So Shanghai in 1984. So it's Dubai in 2020, and Dubai in 1984. At the risk of stating the obvious, we are urbanizing really fast. And at the rate that we're going, by 2050, 70% of our entire population will live in some form of a city. And this is relevant because cities have become the engines for human life. It's where we thrive. But they're really expensive engines to maintain. Cities eat up about 75 to 80% of all the energy we consume globally. And fossil fuels, even today, make up a majority of that supply. This is what energy consumption across the world looks like. And if we take out fossil fuels, that's what it looks like. So in our fight against climate change, it's worth considering that a lot of this fight sits in our cities. Now, I'm a service designer, and for the last year and a half, I've got a chance to jump into many research sessions, facilitate workshops, and map different parts of the transport and city ecosystem as it sits today. And all of this has started making me look at cities a little bit differently. And today, I'd like to share a few things I've learned and share an idea that could be an ally in our fight against climate change and making cities a lot more sustainable. When I zoom out, a city is movement, lots of movement. People, cars, vans, buses, cyclists, all buzzing from one place to another. And all this movement costs the city 25 to 30% of all the energy it consumes. And while this number is significant, it doesn't actually account for the knock-on effect all this movement has on how the city develops in the first place, or how movement makes way for different kinds of economic activity to actually start. So if we start paying attention to how we move, we can actually have a big impact in changing how much energy cities consume and why they consume that energy. And the good news is, it's coming, is that there already is a mobility revolution afoot. Some really powerful ideas that are going to rise up to this challenge. But it's going to take a lot of time for these solutions to manifest, especially globally. So why don't we consider solutions right under our noses? Ideas that already exist that we can build on. What if I told you there was an old piece of technology that could be the key to making our cities a lot more sustainable, a lot more livable, and importantly, a lot more fair? It's something we're all really familiar with. It's called the bus. Now, the bus has a very special relationship with the city. For starters, the bus increases our roads' passenger carrying capacity. And in the space of three cars, a double-decker bus carries about 90 people, something we'd use about 70 cars for on our roads. And of course, it goes without saying, this reduces congestion and it makes our air cleaner, and also saves a lot of time we spend commuting. The bus also allows anyone and everyone in a city to move, movement being the essence of urban living. So without the need to own or rent your own vehicle, you actually get access to hospitals, to schools, to work, and to anything you need for a decent life. Another important thing a bus does is it allows cities to develop a lot more densely. And what that means for you and me is we don't need to take long trips to get to the places we need to go and get the things that we need. Now, these are benefits that you would get for most part from all forms of public transport. One thing that sets the bus apart, especially given how fast we're urbanizing, is that it's much, much easier to scale. The bus doesn't require massive infrastructure spending or planning, and it works quite well with our existing city plans and road networks. And then my favorite. The bus is already everywhere. Every city you go to will have its own type of bus. And I know I put the bus on a pedestal and I've really hyped it up. And it's because of the potential the bus has, which is imagine city life with fewer traffic jams, cleaner air, easy access to everything, and shorter commutes. That'd be quite amazing. But the truth is, the bus is far from perfect. For those of you who take the bus, when was the last time you really enjoyed that bus ride? Or how many times have you been hanging out at a bus stop just because the bus was late? The benefits I mentioned are real, and they show the full capacity at which the bus can change our city lives. But for it to get there, we need to make riding the bus, owning the bus, and managing the bus a lot more easy and pleasant for the city and its citizens. So I really thought about what can we do to make bus services more relevant, and how can we support the bus on this journey to building more sustainable cities? And I thought of three key things. The first thing is we can empower the bus service. And this sits at the government and policy level, where they need to start paying a lot more attention to make the bus service more feasible and more attractive for the people who will use the bus. And what does that mean? That means more space for bus lanes. It means faster, more convenient connections. It means thoughtfully designing routes, so we're actually taking people where they want to go. And importantly, unlocking funding so that we can adopt innovations like electric buses a lot faster. The next thing we can do is innovate. Innovation is something that sits at an organizational level. That's where bus makers, operators, and all the companies in that bus ecosystem come together because they're responsible for delivering a reliable and dependable service. And for them to innovate, it makes sense to start paying closer attention to the experiences and needs of the people outside, like citizens, passengers, the city itself, but also people inside, like service technicians who fix the bus, because that's what's going to empower them to deliver a quality service. And also, a good experience doesn't just make the bus more attractive, it actually makes it a lot more easier to own, manage, and maintain. And then the last action, participation. And that's where all of us come in. And the easiest way to participate is to take the bus, especially when you can and when it makes sense. Taking the bus is probably one of the most effective ways you can reduce your daily carbon footprint. Another way to participate is join the conversation. Telling Google Maps or City Mapper or a similar app that the bus was late or the bus was busy can actually have a knock-on effect on how someone else plans their journey that day. And if you want to take it one step further and you're really enthusiastic, cities across the world have meetups and forums where they're looking for new voices and ideas to really strengthen our discussions and how we move forward towards more sustainable travel in cities. And last but not least, consider voting. Because at the end of the day, it's your taxpayer money and my taxpayer money that actually subsidizes fossil fuels and is being used to sanction much bigger city-level projects. It makes sense to back the people and the ideas that are working towards more sustainable futures. Now, I want to pause for a second on participation because for me, this is one of the most important things. It's one of the few actions that sit within our locus of control of what we can do on a daily basis. And it's also the part, the action, that drives bottom-up energy so that the policymakers on top and the organizations actually start paying attention to what the bus service needs to be. And these actions can then transform a lot of things. For starters, the bus as we know it won't exist. It'll start becoming the best version of itself. And then importantly, it's going to start changing how we move across our cities and how our cities grow. And just to give you a sense of scale, using a bus can help a city save millions of gallons of fossil fuel every year. And if we take a step back, we have more than 10,000 cities across the world. Imagine how much we can change the energy conversation and reduce our demand on energy if we gave a decent bus service to each of these cities. And as we step towards 2050, where 70% of us are living in some form of a city, where the kids of today are now adults, their parents, and they're walking down these streets telling stories of change, I'm optimistic that these can be stories of positive change, because this narrative is something that you and I are fully capable of shaping today. Thank you.